eat fat and get fat. That's what mainstream diet gurus used to say back when low-fat diets reigned and low-fat foods crowded the shelves. Much to obesity researchers' dismay, though, the war on fat didn't stop us from getting fatter and fatter. And so the quest for a better way continued. And fast forward to today, and many people will tell you that the hunt is over, that we finally understand the human metabolism well enough to say that the previous generation of scientists had it all wrong, that they had it backward, actually. And so now we're told to eat fat and burn fat. And this latest revelation has spread through the health and fitness space like chain lightning, giving rise to its own cottage industry of high-fat diets and cookbooks and food products and supplements and so forth. Unfortunately, though, this advice is just as flawed as its antithesis. And in fact, ironically, the exact opposite happens when you eat fat. You see, metabolically speaking, when you eat fat, you gain fat. And that's one of the primary roles of dietary fat, actually, is replenishing body fat stores. But that doesn't mean that eating fat makes you get fatter. Remember that only overeating, consistently eating more energy than you burn, can do that. But that's the subject for another video. And if you want me to make it, then just drop me a comment down below and let me know. In this video, we're going to talk about what types of fat your body needs and how much of them you should be eating every day. So let's start at the top. There are two types of fat found in food, triglycerides and cholesterol. Triglycerides comprise the bulk of our daily fat intake and are found in a wide variety of foods, ranging from dairy to nuts and seeds and meat and more. Now, these fats can be in liquid, unsaturated, or solid, saturated forms, and they help maintain our health in many different ways. They aid in absorbing vitamins, they're used to create various hormones, they keep your skin and hair healthy, and much more. Now, cholesterol is scarcer in our diets, and it's found mainly in foods like eggs, liver, and some fish, butter, and more. It's a waxy substance that's present in all cells of the body, and it's used to make hormones, vitamin D, and various chemicals that help you digest your food better. Now, several decades ago, it was believed that foods that contained cholesterol, like eggs and meat, increased the risk of heart disease. And we now know it's not that simple. Eggs, for instance, have been more or less exonerated, and research shows that processed red meat is associated with high incidence of heart disease, but red meat per se is not. And one of the reasons for this long-standing confusion is foods that contain cholesterol also often contain saturated fat, which can increase the risk of heart disease. Another reason has to do with how cholesterol travels through your body. It's delivered to cells by molecules known as lipoproteins, which are made out of fat and proteins. Now, there are two types of lipoproteins: low-density lipoprotein, LDL, and high-density lipoprotein, HDL. Now, when people talk of bad cholesterol, they're referring to LDL, because research shows that high levels of LDL in your blood can lead to an accumulation in your arteries, which increases the risk of heart disease. And this is why studies show that foods that can raise LDL levels, such as fried and processed foods, as well as foods with saturated fat, can increase the risk of heart disease. HDL, on the other hand, is often thought of as the good cholesterol because it carries cholesterol to your liver, where it is removed from the body. All right, so that's cholesterol. Let's go back to triglycerides. Now, I've mentioned several times so far that there are two forms of triglycerides, saturated and unsaturated. Saturated fat is found in foods like meat, dairy products, eggs, coconut oil, bacon fat, and lard. If a fat is solid at room temperature, it's a saturated fat. Now, the long-held belief that saturated fat increases the risk of heart disease has been challenged by recent studies, which has been a boon to the fad diet industry, not to mention the meat and dairy industries, because we've seen a veritable renaissance of meat and dairy consumption since this research has gone mainstream. The problem, however, is that the research used to promote this movement has also been severely criticized by prominent nutrition and cardiology researchers for various flaws and omissions. These scientists maintain that there is a strong association between high intake of saturated fats and heart disease, and that we should still follow the generally accepted dietary guidelines for saturated fat intake, which is less than 10% of daily calories, until we know more. So, given the research currently available, I don't think we can safely say that all of us, no matter our circumstances or genetic programming, can eat all the saturated fats that we want without any health consequences whatsoever. Now, unsaturated fat is found in foods like olive oil, avocado, nuts, and fish. And if a fat is liquid, it's an unsaturated fat. Now, there are two distinct types of unsaturated fat: monounsaturated fat and polyunsaturated fat. Monounsaturated fat is liquid at room temperature and it starts to solidify when it's cooled, and polyunsaturated fat is liquid at room temperature and when cooled. So foods that are high in monounsaturated fat include canola, olive, and peanut oil, and avocado, and foods high in polyunsaturated fat include safflower, sesame, and sunflower seeds, corn, and many other nuts and their oils. Now, unlike saturated fat, there is no controversy over monounsaturated fat. There's evidence that it can reduce the risk of heart disease, and it's believed to be responsible for some of the health benefits that are associated with the Mediterranean diet, which involves eating a lot of olive oil. Now, polyunsaturated fat, on the other hand, isn't as cut and dried. And that's because the two primary polyunsaturated fats in our diets are alpha-linolenic acid, or ALA, and linolenic acid, or LA. Now, ALA is what is known as an omega-3 fatty acid, and linolenic acid is an omega-6 fatty acid. And these designations just refer to the structure of the molecules. ALA and LA are the only types of fat that we must obtain from our diets because they're essential to our health and our bodies can't produce them. That's why they're referred to as essential fatty acids, or EFAs. So what that means is you could completely remove saturated and monounsaturated fat from your diet and still survive, but if you were to eliminate ALA or LA, you would eventually die. Now, linolenic acid is converted into several compounds in the body, including the anti-inflammatory gamma-linolenic acid, as well as the pro-inflammatory arachidonic acid. Now, it's a bit of an oversimplification to say that the effects of LA are generally bad and the effects of ALA are generally good, but that's more accurate than inaccurate. Now, ALA can be converted into an omega-3 fatty acid called eicosapentaenoic acid, or EPA, and that can be converted into another called docosahexaenoic acid, or DHA. And EPA and DHA are also found in high amounts in fatty fish, which is why people take fish oil supplements, to provide their bodies with adequate EPA and DHA. You see, a massive amount of research has been done on EPA and DHA, and it appears that they bestow many, if not all, of the health benefits that are generally associated with ALA. The bottom line is, we know now that if you want to maintain optimal mental and physical health and well-being, then you need to make sure you're giving your body enough EPA and DHA. Now, there's one more type of unsaturated fat that we need to talk about that you've probably heard of, and that is trans fat, which occurs naturally in some meat and dairy foods, but mainly is found in foods that are manufactured industrially by infusing them with vegetable oil with hydrogen, producing the ubiquitous partially hydrogenated oil that you'll find in many processed foods. Now, trans fat is used primarily to increase the shelf life and palatability of foods, and it's found mostly in junk like fried foods and baked goods, cake mixes, frostings, ice cream, and so forth. Now, I'm not one for dietary absolutism, but there is little argument at this point that artificial trans fats should be eliminated entirely from our diets. Studies show that relatively small amounts of these fats, you know, just a couple grams per day, can increase the risk of a whole host of health problems, including heart disease, Alzheimer's, breast cancer, depression, and more. All right, so now that we have some basic theory under our belts about dietary fat, let's talk about how much we should be eating every day. Now, you've probably heard that you should get at least 20 to 30% of your daily calories from fat to be healthy, but that's not necessarily true. If you're bulking, for example, and you're eating a few thousand calories per day, you definitely don't need to get 30% of those calories from fat to stay healthy. That's why a better target for fat intake is somewhere around 0.3 grams per per pound of fat-free mass per day. And research shows that that is an adequate amount for maintaining overall health, and it also leaves plenty of calories for carbs, which are far more important for gaining muscle and strength than fat. And I am going to be making a separate video on that. Now, when you look at that number in terms of total caloric intake, you'll see that it comes out to about 15 to 20% of daily calories for most of us that work out regularly. For some people, it's going to be a little bit more, and it will never be below 15%. Now, you can go higher than this, of course. You can go up to 30 or even 40% of your daily calories from fat, but I just want you to know that it's not necessary. And also, if you're going to do that, you need to make sure that your saturated fat intake isn't too high. Again, I recommend that we follow the standard guidelines for now, which is no more than 10% of our total daily calories coming from saturated fat. So I would say the reason to go higher fat than what I just said is if you like it, or if you just know that your body feels or does better on a high fat diet. But not because you're afraid that so-and-so says that your endocrine system is gonna fail if you get, you know, less than 25% of your daily calories from fat. And I should also note that it does make sense to go higher in fat and lower in carbs if you're sedentary or if you're very overweight. One other thing is I recommend that you plan on getting the majority of your dietary fat from monounsaturated fats, because those are generally healthiest for your body. And again, that you keep your saturated fat intake below 10% of daily calories. You also should pay special attention to your EPA and DHA intake, because if you're like most people, unless you're eating several servings of fatty fish every week or taking a fish oil supplement or maybe an ALA supplement, your EPA and DHA levels are likely lower than they should be. Now, research shows that 500 milligrams of EPA and DHA per day, and that's combined, that's a bare minimum intake, but I like to see intake closer to 2 grams a day because it gives you quite a few health benefits that you just don't see at 500 milligrams per day. And you can even go higher. You can go up to as high as 6 grams per day for acute anti-inflammatory needs. So that's it for figuring out how much fat to eat every day. It's pretty simple. It just requires a bit of meal planning, a bit of familiarizing yourself with the types of foods that you like to eat and planning it out. And once you do that for a bit, you get some practice with it, it just becomes second nature, really. So I hope you found this video helpful, and if you have, please do give it a like so other people can find it more easily. And also, if you want to be notified when my new videos go live, just subscribe to my channel and you'll be notified. So thank you, and I'll see you in the next video.